This week we have Matthew Rowley joining us, but in the weeks ahead, here's what's going on. Tonight we're talking with Matthew Rowley about unanswered prayer. And I don't know about you, but there are things that I have prayed for, prayed about, and God did not answer the way I expected him to, or it seemed in many times like he was silent. And so we're going to talk about that tonight. Next week, we are going to approach the subject of biblical prophecy and our current times. Is this the end? And so we're going to tackle that question, Matthew and I, together. And then upcoming on May 20th, we have special guest Alicia Hine. And she just recently graduated from Canadian Southern Baptist Seminary. So, there's Alicia. So she is going to be joining us on May 20th. That's two Wednesdays from now. And we're going to be talking about the tabernacle and Jesus. Who Jesus was as the Messiah, how did he fulfill the purposes and the meaning behind much of the things that we find in the building and God's direction in the tabernacle. And so I look forward to that conversation with Alicia in the next couple of weeks. But tonight, here on Your Questions and Some Answers, Matthew and I are going to tackle the question of unanswered prayer. What do we do about it? Is God listening? Etc., etc. And so at this time, let's get Matthew on the line and we will have a conversation together. There he is. Welcome, Matthew.
How's it going?
It is going well. Things are going well out in Cochrane.
Yeah, we're doing pretty good. It was a little bit chilly today, but past that, we're doing good.
Sounds about the same as here in Calgary. So, Matthew, we are talking this week about unanswered prayer. And as someone who's gone through more education than I ever care to attempt, what can you tell me? Have you ever had a situation, or can you relate to someone who says, look, God just has not answered the things that I am praying about or for?
Mm-hmm. Well, I have a number of those, but I was just thinking of one particularly right before we got on together. And when I was preparing to go to a master's degree, I looked around and I said, you know what? I want to go to Oxford University for my master's. And I prayed about it, and I said, you know what, I'm going to put together an application, and I'm going to believe that if God wants me there, I'll go there, and he can do anything. So he can take a guy from a small Bible school, and he can get me to one of the most prestigious universities in the world. So I worked hard. I put together a application passage. I prayed faithfully for weeks that God would open the door, and the door slammed in my face. I got a rejection letter. And I was shattered. I was confused. I had believed so strongly that this was what should happen. And I'd prayed so diligently for it. And yet it all fell around my knees. And I went, what are you doing, Lord? But as time went on, and I looked around and I said, okay, I know God wants me to do a master's degree.
Right.
And I need to know where. He opened the door for me to go to Canadian Southern Baptist Seminary. And among other things, I met you there, which is a great advantage in itself.
Every penny in and of itself.
That's the most important part. But beyond that, I got a fantastic godly education. I was equipped for all the ministry that God had for me.
Right.
And I am where I am today because God answered my prayer, but not in the way that I expected.
Very good. That is awesome. And I mean, I think that probably happens more often than not. I hope tonight we can cover a few biblical stories where we see that happening one way or the other. But what would you say is, I mean, last week we talked about God's word is his primary means of talking to us. That's where we need to hear him. It's laid before us. It's stood the test of time. We hear the story of God in it. If you are someone, or myself included, we find ourselves in a place just not knowing whether God is answering the prayer or if we're praying correctly, where would you either, one, give direct advice in terms of what to do, but two, is there maybe a story in the Bible or somewhere we can point to that someone who's gone before us has had a same or similar experience?
Mm-hmm. Well, of course, the first thing, just to tie in with last week, when Jesus gave us a model prayer, one of the things in there was, thy will be done. Mm-hmm. And when we start out in prayer, we always have to pray in God's will, saying, God, I think I know, but you know for sure. And that sets us up with the right attitude and the right mindset so that as we pray, if our will isn't done, we aren't disappointed because it's about God. But you can look, Daniel is an excellent example of someone who prayed for a long time before seeing the answer to his prayer. If you go to Daniel 10, he prayed for 21 days, sitting by the river, fasting, praying, seeking answers from God, and it was like nothing was happening. But instead of losing heart or losing faith and saying, oh, God hasn't answered my prayer, he persevered in prayer. And at the end of that time, an angel, a messenger from the Lord, actually came and said, hey, I was busy striving with the prince of Persia, fighting my way through to get to you. So because I heard you the moment you prayed, but it took me this long to come to you. So sometimes it's that God has a right time, and it's not that he hasn't answered.
Cool. And is there in that, and actually before I ask the next question, I'd just like to say, anybody joining us tonight, as we engage in this conversation back and forth, and we hope this is a conversation involving more than just Matthew and I, please in the comments, write questions, anything that you'd like to share with us, and we'll try to monitor those and bring those into the conversation as well. Because at the end of the day, we are a community of God, the family of God, pursuing him. And so we do this thing together. All right, back to Daniel. And so there was what you're telling us, Matthew, is in Daniel chapter 10, where he's praying for this 21 days, 3 weeks straight, wondering if God is listening, wondering if God's hearing. I'm going to ask a bit of a, I don't know what kind of question this is, other than maybe, you know, can God create a rock that's too big to move? Is if the angel said to him, look, I had other stuff I was doing, how do we respond to that? Do we say, well, I'm not of high enough priority to God? Those kind of things. What would be your response to a question or statement like that?
Yeah, and that would be to look at God, I think, in a way that maybe other kinds of religions would look at a God, where they, you know, as Elijah taunted on Carmel, maybe your God is sleeping, maybe he's away on a journey. God is everywhere. God is listening to all of us. And if God's timing means that he's going to take some time to answer us, it's only ever for our benefit and for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. He's never too busy
Amen.
To hear every word you say and to care far more than you care. He knows what you're thinking even before you know it yourself. So prayer is that intimate relationship with him, and it is intimate. It is close.
Awesome. Yeah, I very much agree. It's not always easy. I know in the relationships that I have, and for Ange and I, my close friends, our kids, relationships are not always easy. They often are a challenge, and that it's no different with God, but they're worth it. They're worth it. The relationship with God is worth it. So let's jump maybe to a couple of weeks when we're talking to Alicia. We're going to talk about Jesus and his fulfillment of the tabernacle, or the representation found of the tabernacle in him, or vice versa, depending on how you want to look at that. Jesus' relationship with God was perfect. He was God. The Father, Son, and Spirit are in this almost inexplicable, impossible to understand Trinitarian relationship. Do we see Jesus struggling in prayer, wondering about unanswered prayer?
Yeah. Well, I mean, first of all, you see Christ praying constantly to his Father, slipping away, praying, as we talked about last week. And in the Garden of Gethsemane, you see a powerful time where Christ, it wasn't that he was worried that God wasn't answering, but Christ asked for something. He said, Father, if it be your will, take this cup from me.
Right.
Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Jesus was ready to go through what he had to do, but he still felt bold enough to go to his Father and say, if there's any other way, can you take this from me? Ready and willing and able to go through it, but not wanting to be the one to bear that wrath if there was any other way. So we see in that sometimes we can pray and we can ask for something and God won't give it, not because it is he doesn't hear us or it's an unanswered prayer, but because God has something better. God has something more important. And that's especially important when we think of sickness, or when we think of difficult relationships or these other problems where we just want the pain to go away.
Right.
And sometimes God says, I know that I have something for you. Paul had a famous incident where he prayed three times that a thorn in his flesh would be removed.
Right.
And instead of the thorn being taken away, God came to him and he said, my grace is sufficient for you because power is perfected in weakness.
That is awesome. Very good. So when we're talking about Daniel, we're talking about Jesus. In my mind, I mean, Jesus, Son of God, but Daniel is this very prominent figure in the Old Testament. He's referred to an awful lot in the New Testament. But what about just an ordinary person, just someone who's, are there examples in the Bible maybe of someone like you or I or members of the congregation or any congregation that could relate to a situation or we would relate to? I have trouble relating to Jesus. I do have trouble relating to Daniel. But what about just an average person that had a common prayer that didn't seem to be answered or maybe took a long time in coming?
Yeah. Well, in 1 Samuel, you actually have the case of Hannah, who desperately wanted to have a child. She was totally childless, loved by her husband, but the other wife of the husband had lots of children and taunted her. And she felt like her world was totally incomplete and falling apart. And she was praying for months and perhaps years. She was begging God to have a child. And it seemed like there was no answer. And then one day, as she was in the temple, once again praying, tabernacle at the time, begging God, she was praying so fervently that Eli actually thought she was drunk and that she was carrying on uproariously. You can imagine the tears and the cries that were coming out to make someone think this woman is drunk. And finally, at long last, after years of wishing and hoping and praying for something that seemed to have no answer, Samuel was born to her. And not only did she get a great child, but she was able to devote that child to the Lord in the right time. And that child became Samuel the prophet.
Right. Very good. That's awesome. And yeah, Hannah was just an obscure character. Someone who was there and a second wife of that, which is kind of a brutal situation to find oneself in.
Yeah. And it's important to remember sometimes, like you look at that case, what she wanted, if she had just prayed once and got the child, perhaps she wouldn't have actually dedicated him to the Lord. We don't know. But sometimes God wants us to travail in prayer for a while and seek his face so that we can be brought around to the right timing and to the right purpose in our prayers.
Cool. Timing and purpose. Those are some good ways to help us reorient to difficult situations and unanswered prayers. We do, Matthew, actually have a couple of comments that have come through. One is from a friend of ours, Alette. And yes, you have actually met Alette when you preached at Crescent last year. And so Alette asked this, is fasting still applicable when needing an answer from God? Does it enhance your prayer time?
Amen. Amen. There's nothing like stripping away the flesh to pray. I actually spent this Wednesday afternoon myself. I fast every Wednesday for some of the ministries that I'm doing. And the scriptures are very clear that when we fast, it's controlling the flesh. It's saying to the flesh, sit down, I'm going to talk to God. And so, of course, there's God calls people to different times, and it's not that God won't hear us if we don't fast.
Right.
But as we fast and as we say, I am devoting myself in a physical way to focus on prayer, then it does actually help us to have confidence. And it seems to be very effective for building our prayer life and our walk with God. Anytime that we say to our flesh, sit down, I have to spend time with God in any way, it's a healthy thing to do.
Right. And I don't want to read it, Alette, I don't want to read into your question in this, but I know it's a question in the back of my mind, and I've heard it elsewhere. Is the idea of working? So does fasting, if I'm hearing you correctly, fasting is a discipline on our behalf, an opening up of ourselves so we can hear God better. But what I've also heard is language that says, where fasting becomes, God, I'm doing this for you so that I can hear you better. Where fasting becomes more of a work. Like I've fasted, I've prayed, I've read my Bible every day, those kinds of things. What do you have to say when there's that striving in prayer that we're not getting an answer to? And is there a check in our heart or our mind that we can maybe address to say, hey, maybe this prayer is more about me and less about God?
Yeah, well, we find that in James. He actually tells us that you have not because you ask not, and you have not because you ask it amiss to consume it of your lusts. So sometimes, because of our lack of relationship with God and lack of openness to his will, we can get to a point where we pray for something, because we just want it, or because we want it for selfish reasons. You know, a great example is the number of people who've said, oh, I'm praying that I'll win the lottery and I promise I'll give 10% to the church. But it's a wrong way of looking at it, that I'm going to pray to God as my heavenly bellboy and I'm going to get something and maybe then I'll give it to God. But it's about me and where I'm at. And we actually have a wonderful example in Jonah, where Jonah the prophet goes on behalf of God after being drugged there basically by God, preaches to the people of Nineveh.
Right.
They fast, they pray, they turn to God. And Jonah goes on a hill and prays to God and says, how come you're not destroying them? I wanted them destroyed. And you just sit there looking and going, Jonah, God just miraculously saved all these people.
Right.
And you want them destroyed, and that's your prayer?
Right.
So at times like that, when God doesn't answer our prayers, it's a great mercy.
Hmm.
Now, there's a fantastic theologian, Tyler, one of my favorites, a guy named Garth Brooks. Okay, not really a theologian, but he has a song called Sometimes I Thank God for Unanswered Prayers. And it's just talking about how he prayed so fervently to have this girlfriend of his become his wife.
Right.
And years later, he met her and realized, wow, I would have been sad about that. And sometimes the way it is for us, where down the road, we realize maybe what I prayed for so fervently wouldn't have been so good.
Very good. We got another question here from a couple more. Ian asks this. Ian, thanks for your question. We often understand prayer answers that take us in another direction, God's direction, but I'm wrestling with prayer that remains essentially unanswered, other than not yet. Like, it's just, there's just nothing. Do you have any words of encouragement for Ian in that regard?
One of the biggest things that I do when I am travailing in prayer and I feel like I'm not getting an answer is I look at my life and I say, is there an area that has not been submitted to Christ? Because sometimes the block is not in my prayer, but it's where, because I'm not submitted, either I'm looking in the wrong direction or there is something. It actually says that sin has a way of getting in between us and God and actually limiting the effectiveness of our prayer and our walk with God, because we're not connected with him. We're not close to him. There's a barrier of sin. So for me, a case like that happened when I was out in Ontario, and I thought I heard from the Lord that I should be pastoring. And I was praying that I could find the pastorate, and yet the answer didn't come. And I looked at my life and I realized I had fear about my life and the future, and I was working out of fear, not out of submission to God's will. And I had to deal with that before I could carry on in seeking his will.
Right. So there's a lot of self-examination that goes into a situation where we're just not hearing a response from God, whether that's just our own sin, an unrelated sin that's causing trouble, or something that's impeding how we're praying. But your suggestion or advice would be that maybe there's some self-reflection that needs to happen there, and digging out of what's rooting around maybe in our hearts and minds. Okay, thanks for that, Matthew. Thanks for the question, Ian. We have another question here from Alicia. Alicia, who's going to be joining us in a couple of weeks. She has got a question. She says this, if God has already determined what he's going to do, why should we pray for what we want? Doesn't that just set us up to have our prayers remain unanswered?
Mm. There's a great quote that says, love the Lord and then do as you please. And the same works with our prayers. Mm. God has indeed got a plan for us. He's got it mapped out. We can trust in him. But God is interested in bringing us to his will. He doesn't just manhandle us around, but he actually has a way of helping us to get on board with him. And prayer is one of those key things. So taking that time to pray and to dwell with him. Sometimes we get overly focused on the petitions part, just praying to develop our will.
Right.
And sometimes prayer just needs to be about dwelling in the presence of God and being with him and going to our dad and saying, I need a big hug right here, Lord, because my peace is not here. My hope is not here. My joy is not here. I need you. There's a wonderful song, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. And that's the picture that we have to have when we're going to God and we're not feeling like we're close to him or in his will. It's okay to just go to God and say, Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. As happened in the scriptures. It's okay to say, I'm weak and I'm coming to you because you're the only safe place to be.
Right. And so, yeah, and again, I think last week we went through the ACTS, the acts, adoration, confession, thanksgiving, and supplication. And yeah, I know I have found myself at times where I spend a lot of time on that S, on the supplication, and wondering about when God is going to answer prayers, et cetera, in that regard, and forgetting that there's an adoration, confession, and thanksgiving. And 3/4 of that formula, I should hesitate to use that word, but 3/4 of that is about just purely relationship. And then there's that last bit that's about asking. And so when we, again, maybe it's similar to, most car accidents happen within X number of kilometers of a person's house. Well, that's where they spend most of their time. And so if we're spending most of our time simply asking God for things, and then we wonder why he's not hearing us or why we're not answering, maybe it's because we haven't spent some other time in some recognizing who he is and drawing close in relationship to him.
Yeah, so true. Yeah. It can be a powerful thing too when you just rest in him. Sometimes we get this idea that if we just said the right incantation, the right series of words, we'd somehow unlock the power of God or the will of God. But we don't do magic when we pray. We don't try to bend God to our will. We can just trust that if we come to him with an open heart, even if we screw the prayer up, even if we do the wrong thing, God does not depend on us before he starts acting, or he would never act, because we're all bad sometimes. We all mess up sometimes. We're all failed sometimes. So he works even when we don't think that we deserve for him to work in our life.
Very good. Well, it looks like those are the questions that we have of people that have asked here on our live broadcast tonight. Do you have, Matthew, we're nearing our half hour mark at 7:30. Do you have any last direction, guidance, suggestions, things that you would want us to know when we think about prayer in general or unanswered prayer in particular?
I would just encourage people, if you are feeling like you have a blockage in your prayer life, if you're struggling with taking that time, sometimes 5 minutes feels like an eternity, take some time, sit down with the Psalms and just pray them. Just read them out loud, think of what they mean and pray them. But don't feel like you're a failure if, don't set yourself a timer or a clock and say, I'm going to pray for 15 minutes. Just sit down. Talk to God. Prayer is something that we develop as a discipline, and it can sometimes take a little bit of work. But reading the Psalms is a great way to start. Praying the Psalms, where the words have already been written and they're good words, and they will launch you off into a good prayer time. And when you're especially feeling low and like God's not answering you, David has a lot of those Psalms that are wonderfully encouraging for someone who feels like they're not hearing God moving and speaking in their life.
Very good. That is some good stuff. I agree with you. That's one of the things I've been trying to do lately is to write my prayers. Because I know in my mind I can think through things quickly, but as soon as I have to write, it slows me down a little bit. It makes me contemplate what it is I'm trying to say or formulate my words differently. And I found that helpful. And I agree. Reading the Psalms is a beautiful way. The older I get, the more I read them, the more I realize I don't need any words because all the words that are needed have already been spoken. And
Amen.
so, despite my overuse of words, as my kids and wife always say. But thank you very much, Matthew. I think we will call it a night there. It has been a great night. I look forward to connecting with you again next week as we talk about what are we talking about next week? Oh, yes, biblical prophecy and our current times. Is this the end? And so, we look forward to having a conversation with you, going through maybe some of the Old Testament. The prophecies from back then, and some of the encouragements and warnings that Jesus gave us. And then looking at our present time and saying, how is what was said in Scripture thousands of years ago applicable to today? And what do we have to be concerned about? What do we have to be listening to? How do we need to be responding to our current times and the situations we see where there's all sorts of difficulty around the world? And so, with that, we look forward to connecting once again next week. Congratulations. Actually, before we go, I should have one final congratulations for Matthew. He was just voted in this past Sunday at Cremona Christian Fellowship. Do I have that name correct?
Cremona Country Fellowship.
Cremona Country Fellowship. Matthew's going to be part-time out there as the lead or senior pastor. And so he's getting all his T's crossed and I's dotted in terms of the formality of it. But he's been unanimously welcomed. unanimously voted in as pastor out there. And so he and his wife and family will remain in Cochrane, and they will commute up to Cremona, but it's pretty quick in a rather rural kind of setting anyway. And so congratulations, Matthew. I'm excited for you. And as you continue the journey that God has set for you, both with now with the church, but also with TLI, Training Leaders International, may the road continue to be filled by God's light and as you follow in his steps. And so thank you,
Amen.
Church, for joining tonight. Thank you for being a part of the conversation. For those who ask questions, we encourage that. Please continue to send us questions, whether by email, on Instagram, Facebook, phone call, text message, carrier pigeon, whatever it is. Get us the questions so we can continue discussing your questions with some answers. It's been a great night. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May he turn his face to you and give you peace. Amen.